So, welcome back, and also a warm welcome from my side. My name is Rudi Brunner, and I take over from Peter for the second part of this afternoon. For the next session, which is about what's next in computing, from bits to qubits, we'll have two speakers. First, we have Xavier Vask, Director of Worldwide IBM Garage for Systems, and Certified Distinguished Data Scientist, leading a worldwide technical team providing deep expertise on current and next generation technology. Second, Olivier Hess, leader at IBM Quantum France. He's member of the IBM Quantum Computing Team Europe, as member of the IBM Quantum Computing Team, and working closely to IBM Research and the worldwide team. He is leading the IBM Quantum France activities and the strategic partnerships. So welcome both of you. Xavier, you can start with your presentation, please. Thanks.
Thank you very much, Rudi, thank you for giving us the opportunity to speak about this presentation, What's Next in Computing. The goal of this presentation is to give you a flavor of what will happen in terms of technology and specifically hardware technology for the next decade. And the objective is also to give you this flavor across a few examples on the, let's say, the technology that is being developed so far. So fasten your seatbelt and let's travel from the current to the next decade technology. First of all, we can start with the classical computing. And we see from the past and today that classical computing has experienced remarkable progress guided by Moore's law and the von Neumann architecture. And the law, as you know, tells us that every 2 years we double the number of transistors in a processor, and at the same time we increase performance by 2 or reduce costs by 2. And this pace has slowed down a little bit over the past decade and is currently experiencing a phase of inflection, but also of emerging technologies driving this transition. And the goal is really to rethink information technology, rethink the hardware, and in particular move towards heterogeneous system architectures with specific accelerators in order to really meet the need for performance. And what is also very interesting in that is that the advances in the last century and specifically on a few domains such as neuroscience, physics, laws of physics, help us to advance computing today. So and we will see that in a couple of minutes. So the slide you have just in front of you, and the guy who is on the slide is Claude Shannon. He's an engineer, mathematician, and one of the information theory's father. He worked 20 years at MIT, and alongside his academic activities, he worked at Bell Laboratories. He came with this information theory and also the binary that is used by the classical computers that appeared in the middle of the 20th century. And it's when mathematics and information were combined in a new way to form information theory, launching both the computer industry and telecommunication. And the strength of binary lies on its simplicity and reliability. And a byte is real easy to understand. It's either 0 or 1, a state that can be easily measured, calculated, communicated, or stored. Today's computer and high-performance computer, for example, are based on this really simple principle. So we think that the data center of tomorrow is a data center made up of heterogeneous systems which will run heterogeneous workloads. It will be equipped with binary, but also biologically inspired and quantum accelerators. And these architectures will be the foundations to address many challenges in the future. And we need to manage these heterogeneous systems, a layer that will orchestrates everything. And like an orchestra conductor, the hybrid cloud seems to be the right solution, and it will make it possible to set these systems to music, thanks also to a layer of security and intelligent automation. And we can give a simple example of the power of the current technologies. And the first example can be IBM Z. It's a system that is able to do many stuff. It's a chip engraved in 14 nanometers and containing 9.1 billion transistors. In a single system, we are able to process 19 billion encrypted transactions per day and 1,000 billion web transactions per day. The IBM Z systems, all the IBM Z systems installed across the globe, can process actually 87% of bank card transaction and 8 trillion payment per year, and not 7 as it's written in the presentation. So and as Mark said, can consider it as a private cloud, and we can also deploy in one single system 2.4 million Docker containers in the single system, and consequently reduce significant data center space, reduce costs, and do energy savings. So all these numbers to say that the binary system such as the IBM Z has an important role in our economy and is driven many things in our economy. And the power of this simple principle with zero and ones can do extraordinary things. The same can be applied to submit one of the most powerful computers in the world. This computer helps model supernovas, design new materials, explore solutions against cancer, study genetics and the environment. And when we look at its configuration, is pretty amazing. More than 9,000 IBM Power9 processors, CPUs, more than 27,000 GPUs. It delivers more than 200 petaflops, and has the 250 petabytes of storage capacity. Even with these really impressive numbers, and even with this amazing cutting-edge technology, we cannot compute everything. We cannot store everything. We have still bottlenecks that exist, in particular with the von Neumann architectures. And we need to find ways to avoid these bottlenecks and make systems even more powerful to address the many challenges we have in front of us, for example, in science. And one of the way to improve that is biology, to combine biology and the information theory. For example, in the data science field, as Mark explained very well, the need of computing power is compensated by deporting workloads to, for example, GPUs, but also FPGAs, field programmable gate array, which can realize the desired digital functions. But there is a need to find other ways to compute, and we can find an inspiration through the progress in the field of neuroscience that will allow to design new types of processors directly inspired by the way the brain transmits information. And the guy you see on the bottom right of the slide is Santiago Ramón y Cajal, a Spanish histologist and neuroscientist, Nobel Prize in Physiology and Medicine in 1906 with Camillo Golgi. And thanks to them, we better know the architecture of the nervous system. And most important is the way neurons communicate with each other. And we know better the structure of the way they communicate through an axon and synapse and so on. And thanks to that, we were able to design a couple of systems, and I can give you a brief example. Mike talked a little bit about it. We published in Science, so with university partners, a processor called TrueNorth, made up of a million neurons. The chip consumes only 70 milliwatts and is capable of 46 billion synaptic operations per second, which it's a quite huge amount. So 36 billion synaptic operations per second and per watt, literally a synaptic supercomputing holding in a hand. And we have moved from neuroscience to supercomputers in the new computing architecture, in the a new way to program also with new programming language, new algorithms, new applications, and now a new chip. So TrueNorth is a neuromorphic CMOS integrated circuit produced by IBM in 2014, so not so far. And it's a many core processor network with some capabilities. So I already say that over 1 million neurons, but the total number of programmable synapses is slightly more than 268 million. So it's a pretty huge number. And the number of basic transistors in this processor is 5.4 billion. So TrueNorth really bypasses the bottleneck of the von Neumann architecture and is very energy efficient. And it's a new way to calculate. There is many research going on neuromorphic computing. It's just one example. And definitively, the brain will be a source of inspiration for designing new systems. Another example is DNA. DNA is also a source of inspiration. In this case, is more for storing data. A team recently published in the journal Science the capacity to store digital data on a DNA molecule. They were able to store an operating system, a French movie from 1895, a scientific article, a virus, a photo, a $50 gift, a card in a DNA strands, and retrieved data without errors, which is quite amazing. And indeed, when you think about it, a DNA molecule is intended to store information by nature. Genetic information is four nitrogenous bases or nucleotides, you can call it nucleotide, that make up a DNA molecule, the famous A, C, T, G, if you remember the biology courses at school. And today it is possible to transcribe digital data into a new code. And DNA sequencing then makes it possible to read the stored information. And encoding is automated through a software. And when you think about it, a DNA molecule is 3 billion nucleotides. And 1 gram of DNA, we can easily think that we can store more than 200 petabytes of data. And just to give you an image, under, let's say, good conditions, we can store a lot of data in a very few grams of DNA. So that's quite impressive. And it's estimated that DNA could still be deciphered after several million years, thanks to longevity genes, and DNA can withstand the most extreme weather conditions. Of course, it's a research paper, it's a research program, so there is let's say, weaknesses still, like the height costs and the processing times, which can be extremely, extremely long, but that's research, and maybe this is something we can see in the next decade to store data. And then comes physics. When you combine physics, the law of physics and information, and the law of physics help us also to imagine the computer of tomorrow. And of course, we can easily think about the quantum computing that a lot of people and a newspaper are talking about. But let me start with a single example with the atom. In an article published in Nature, IBM physicists and engineers have described how they achieved the feat of writing and reading data in an holmium atom, a single holmium atom. And it's a really rare earth element. This is a symbolic step forward, but proves that this approach works, simply works, and that we might one day have atomic data storage. To compare what does it mean, image that we can store the entire iTunes library of 35 million songs on a device the size of a credit card. In the paper, the nanoscientists demonstrated the ability to read and to write 1 bit of data on one atom, That's pretty amazing. And for comparison, today's hard disk drives use more than 100,000 to 1 million atoms to store a single bit of information. So you can compare the amazing difference when you look at the storage in the Ulmium atom. So that's research also. That doesn't mean that we will have this tomorrow, but we can easily imagine in the next decade that we can have this type of technologies coming on. And of course, quantum computing, Olivier will talk about it, just a few words on it. We cannot avoid, of course, discussing about quantum computer. Quantum bits or qubits combine physics with information and are the basic units of a quantum computer. So in a way, binary is very simple, zero and ones. And here we have another way to think about the single unit of computational model that we call it qubits. And it's based on the law of quantum physics. Properly designed quantum algorithms are capable of solving problems of great complexity by exploiting quantum superposition and entanglement to assess an exponential state space and also by amplifying the probability of calculating the correct response by constructive interference. Olivier will speak it about it later. What is interesting is under the impulse of the physicist and Nobel Prize winner Richard Feynman, that the idea of the design and development of quantum computers was born. And beyond this technological progress, quantum computing opens the way to processing of computer tasks whose complexity is really beyond the reach of our current computers. Even with a submit supercomputer, we are not able to calculate this kind of challenges. And you have many use cases where you cannot use even the most powerful computer in the world to compute this problem or this challenge. So the future of computing is a combination of all I've been talking about. The future is really about building a data center with heterogeneous systems made up of classical computing called binary or bit systems, biologically inspired computing, and quantum computing called quantum or qubit systems. And to manage all of this, we will need to have another technology, the hybrid cloud architecture that will mask the complexity while allowing the secure use and sharing of private and public systems and data. And AI also is a very important thing because it will allow us to bring opportunities for progress and apply to the management and optimization of the entire data center of the future. A few words also about what will happen, how the technology will help us to solve a couple of things. First, it will allow accelerated discoveries. And for example, one of the application, for example, of quantum computing is design and build new materials. And it's really essential for different industries. Also, it will the new technology will also allow us to build more intelligent mission critical processes. And when you look, for example, at the science of new materials, it's very interesting. It can be applied to many industries. And I refer to the question of Manuel Rodriguez Viguri in the Q&A, where he asked about the CO2 footprint, about the high demand of metals and minerals consumption to build and manufacture those edge. And it's clear that new materials will be necessary. And to address and design new materials, we will need technologies like AI, but also quantum computing to design, for example, the batteries of the future. Today, the batteries of the future, they are made up of lithium or cobalt. And of course, by addressing the challenge in another way, we will be certainly able to design new kind of batteries that are more sustainable. And of course, we can apply this kind of design of new materials in a lot of industries like agriculture, natural resources, aviation, transportation, electronics, healthcare, etc. So this will need a different way to compute, and quantum computing can be the answer. And to speak about it, I hand over to Olivier to explain this statement. Olivier, Over to you. Thank you.
Thank you, Jose. So just a few words. So as you may remember, in May 2016, we at IBM, we announced this quantum ready phase, meaning that at this stage, we had a first 5-qubit system. We also developed a quantum environment called Qiskit. And the main objective was to put this system available in the cloud and have our partners trying and accessing these first building blocks to start growing their knowledge on quantum computing. We are still in this phase, and I will show you where we are today and how the size of the system are today and what is the maturity of the different building blocks we are developing in this quantum ready phase. But the IBM ambition short term is to demonstrate what we're calling the quantum advantage, meaning that in 3, 5, 8 years from now, we expect to be able to demonstrate the advantage of a quantum computer on a particular algorithm, on a particular problem, meaning that a quantum computer plus an identified use case will be able to solve faster a given problem compared to a classical approach. And this is what we as IBM were pursuing, is to demonstrate, I would say, short to medium term, this quantum advantage. In the slide just after, as Xavier said, Xavier, can you change the slide, please? The very basic block, as you may remember, in a classical computer, you have bits, and a bit can be 0 and 1. These are the building blocks of a classical computer. As Xavier said, in a quantum computer, the basic unit is a qubit, a quantum bit. And this quantum bit will embed, I would say, the two basic properties of the quantum physics called superposition and entanglement. I won't spend time on this, but just to give you the flavor, in a bit, you can describe two states, 0 and 1. With this superposition, a qubit can describe 0 or 1 or something between 0 and 1 at the same time, meaning that a qubit can describe an infinite number of value where a bit is only restricted to two states, 0 and 1. And these are the two basics of a quantum computer. Just in the slide just after, the two main challenges required to build a quantum computer. First of all, of course, you need to be able to build a qubit, a quantum bit. And I won't spend time on how it works, but this is the basic building blocks. But of course, this is not enough. One qubit is not enough, and in particular, if you want to build a quantum computer, you need to add many, many, many qubits. And this is a key challenge, how to scale a quantum computer, and in particular, when growing the number of qubits in a single chip, what is the best communication, best topology to interconnect all these qubits? And as you can see in this slide, it's a key challenge, and with IBM, we are testing, validating different approach to connect at best different qubits. And in particular, on this slide, this you see what is the 65-qubit system looks like, and in particular, what is the topology we decide to choose for optimal behavior of this 65-qubit system. Keep in mind, so two basic problems. One, to have the qubit capacity, and also how to interconnect many qubits. And in the slide just after, you will see how the final system looks like. And again, I won't spend time on how it works, but just as you can see, at the point of this blue line, you have the chip. On this chip, you have the different qubits interconnected, as I was just describing. What you see on top of this is all the cabling, I would say, to be able to send to the qubit signal. And this is how you will program a quantum computer, is by sending to each qubit a signal. But key challenge here again is to be able to exhibit from the qubit this quantum capacity, this superposition and entanglement. As you can see, you need to cool down the system at zero Kelvin, meaning that when the system will be at this temperature around minus 277 Celsius, then you will exhibit from the qubit this quantum properties, and then the system will behave as quantum. And this is the third main challenge to be able to build a quantum computer, is also what you are calling this cryogenic environment, to be able to have the system, and in particular the qubit, in the proper environment to exhibit this quantum effect. And in the slide just after, what you see is also the final solution. I mean, and this is the topic of the presentation today, cloud. And of course, the system is hosted in the cloud, and all our systems are accessible through the cloud. From your prem on the left-hand side, you will program, you will develop your own algorithm, and you will submit to the system in the cloud. You will access a quantum service in the cloud. This is why, and in the key challenge, we are, of course, developing the different hardware building blocks for growing and building a quantum computer. But all this environment, cooling and accessing in the cloud, is a key challenge we, as IBM, we are facing today. Just to give you, in the next slide, a few words on where we are going. I was mentioning a few minutes ago this quantum ready phase. And today, as I was mentioning on the top, on the bottom of this slide, you see today we do have 65 qubit system. And we all know that 65 qubits is not enough to demonstrate the quantum advantage. So we need to grow more qubits. And in this slide, you see the IBM roadmap that we announced a few months ago, that was in September, growing from 65 qubits to more than 1,000 qubits in 3 years from now. And again, our ambition is that when we will be able to have such a system with more than 1,000 qubits, if in parallel we have the right algorithm, the right use cases, then we expect to be able to demonstrate what I was mentioning as quantum advantage a few minutes ago. And on top of this hardware roadmap, and I won't comment it, just keep in mind that we do have a strong software roadmap to provide the tools, the libraries, all the environment to ease the access of a system, and in particular to ease the development of a quantum algorithm. Just one word also on the next slide, to show you the challenges. Keep in mind that, of course, we need to add more qubits, that's for sure, but we also need to add the quality of the qubit. And to do that, we introduce a law called the quantum volume, which is a kind of, I would say, Moore's law that Xavier just was mentioning. And this quantum volume is the capacity to improve the quality of the qubit independently of the number of qubits, meaning that we were in the roadmap of improving each year, doubling this quantum volume, meaning that we improve the quality of the system, the quality of the qubit, and this is not directly correlated to the number of qubits. This is a strong also involvement from us to improve the quality of the system through the quantum volume. Now, a few words on what are the main topics, application for quantum computing. As you can see on this slide, on the next slide, there are three main topics that we are addressing for a quantum computer. As you all know, the main objective is not to replace a classical computer, but to be able to run better, faster, some problems. And in this slide, you see some main domain where we think that a quantum computer will improve the way you will program or you will add this problem. And in particular today, we have three main topics where we are investigating some algorithm. Of course, the quantum simulation, material science, physics, chemistry. On the right-hand side, all the problems related to optimization, what we're calling quantum walks, and there are many, many topics there. And on the last slide also, in the middle of the slide, all the problems which are solving a very complex problem, linear solution, and this is also where quantum computer will provide benefit and in particular capacity to solve very complex problem in a very short period of time. Just one additional example and collaboration, as we as IBM, we do have with some customers, and you see the name on the right hand side. Again, I see that the time flies. So many problems on different industry, finance, chemistry, energy, finance, retail, and all the problems you see on this slide are problems where the complexity of the solution is, I would say, illegible and compatible with a quantum computer, and where we can extract value of running a given algorithm on a quantum computer. And as you can see, there are many, many, many use cases arising, providing a real advantage of quantum computer near or medium term. Just one word on this topic. I briefly mentioned this quantum computing capacity. And some of you may know that also one topic opened by a quantum computer is security and quantum safe. I won't address this topic today, but keep in mind that a quantum computer will have the capacity to solve very complex problems, one of them being to decrypt an RSA key. And this is something which is very important to keep in mind. This is, of course, not a use case, but this is a consequence of the arising of quantum computer, and in particular, how to protect the environment from the arrival of this system. Just keep in mind that there are solutions today existing to fight against this quantum computing, and in particular for security and quantum safety. Just last word on this slide. On top of the hardware and software development, we also started an initiative called the IBM Quantum Network. And the main objective here is to have education, training, and in particular, working with different use case, different partners on identifying use cases. And education is a key topic. And in the next slide, just to show you, in the next slide again, exactly. Just to show you, what is the ecosystem where we are working with the different partners you see on this slide, and in particular, depending the industry, that can be finance, that can be chemistry, that can be aerospace, that can be retail. We are working with the name you see on this slide through joint development. And the main objective is to say in 3, 5, 6 years from now, we will have the current hardware available. We will have the environment for this, but we also need to have use cases. And the main objective of this quantum network is to work with partners, with IBM clients, to identify industry by industry potential use cases and start thinking of how to rethink a given algorithm that today works on a classical computer to tomorrow on a quantum computer. And this is a key topic and the main initiative IBM is pushing. I will stop here. Just on the next slide, you have some links if you want to go further. Of course, in part, if you need to keep the discussion live, of course, get back to us, get back to Xavier, myself, and we will be pleased to pursue this discussion and to deep dive a little bit better and deeper the topics we mentioned today.